have a new job.
Yeah?
No.
That's how.
social media to children and teens on social media. We really appreciate your being here, Mr. Mosseri. Your response to our invitation is very welcome. I want to thank you and your team for your cooperation, and I want to thank the ranking member, Senator Blackburn, for being such a really close partner in this work, as well as our chairwoman, Maria Cantwell, and our ranking member, Roger Wicker, for their support as well, and all the members of our committee for being so engaged on this topic. As a note to start, I understand Mr. Mosseri has a hard stop at 5, so I'm going to be strict on the 5-minute time limit. I know everybody thinks of me as a very nice guy, but I'm going to be ruthless, at least attempting to be ruthless, as best any senator can be with his colleagues. In this series of hearings, we've heard some pretty powerful and compelling evidence about the dangers of big tech to children's health, well-being, and futures. Our nation is in the midst of a teen mental health crisis. Social media didn't create it, but it certainly fanned the fuel, fanned the flames, and it's fueled it. And if anybody has any doubts about the potential harmful effects of social media, the Surgeon General yesterday issued a powerful report about the implications of social media as well as video gaming and other technologies on teen mental health. And that's part of the reason we're here. The hearings have shown that social media, in particular big tech, actually fans those flames with addictive products and sophisticated algorithms that can exploit and profit from children's insecurities and anxieties. And our mission now is to do something about it. We're here to do more than shake fists. We really are seeking solutions. And we welcome the voices and the vision of big tech itself in that effort. I believe that the time for self-policing and self-regulation is over. Some of the big tech companies have said, trust us. That seems to be what Instagram is saying in your testimony. But self-policing depends on trust. The trust is gone. What we need now is independent researchers, objective overseers, not chosen by big tech, but from outside, and strong, vigorous enforcement of standards that stop the destructive, toxic content that now too often is driven at kids and takes them down rabbit holes to dark places. The day before this hearing, Instagram announced a set of proposals, these simple time management and parental oversight tools should have, they could have been announced years ago. They weren't, and in fact, these changes fall way short of what we need, in my view. Many of them are still in testing, months away. The rollouts will be done at some point in the future. We don't know exactly when. And unfortunately, these announced changes leave parents and kids with no transparency into the black box algorithms, the 600-pound gorillas in those black boxes that drive that destructive and addictive content to children and teens. No effective warning or notice to parents when their children are spiraling into eating disorders, bullying, or self-harm. Nothing more than the bare minimum controls for parents, and of course, no real accountability to assure parents and kids that these safeguards will work. I'm troubled with the lack of answers on Instagram Kids. Once again, this pause looks more like a public relations tactic brought on by our hearings, just as these announced changes seem to be brought on by these proceedings announced just hours before your testimony. And we need real, serious review of those changes. The magnitude of these problems requires bold and broad solutions and accountability, which has been lacking so far. Facebook's own researchers have been warning management, including yourself, Mr. Mosseri, for years about Instagram's harmful impacts on teens' mental health and well-being, and the whistleblower who sat exactly where you are told us about those documents, about the research, the studies, which showed that Facebook knew, it did the research, it had the studies, but it continued to profit from the destructive content because it meant more eyeballs, more advertising, more dollars. Given those warnings, it seems inexcusable that Facebook waited a decade to begin, and only to begin, figuring out that Instagram needed parental controls. In the past 2 months, this subcommittee has heard horrifying stories from countless parents whose lives and their children's lives have been changed forever. One father from Connecticut wrote to me about his daughter who developed severe anxiety in high school because of constant pressure from Instagram. That pressure became so intense following her home from school, following her everywhere she went, following her into her bedroom in the evening, that she attempted suicide. Fortunately, her parents stepped in and sought help and found a recovery program, but the experience continues to haunt her and her family. Facebook's researchers call this fall into that kind of dark rabbit hole a perfect storm. That's the quote, perfect storm, created by its own algorithm that exacerbate downward spirals harmful to teens. Again, Facebook knows about the harm. It's done the research, the studies, the surveys repeatedly. It knows the destructive consequences of the algorithms and designs. It knows teens struggle with addiction and depression on Instagram. But that data has been hidden, like the algorithms themselves. Just yesterday, that Surgeon General's report provided powerful documentation on how social media can fan those flames and fuel the fires of the mental health crisis that we face among teens. And it signals that something is terribly wrong. What really stuns me is the lack of action. In fact, just within the last 2 months, 2 months ago, this subcommittee heard testimony from Facebook's global head of safety, Ms. Antigone Davis. At that time, I showed her the pro-eating disorder rampant on Instagram. I demonstrated through an experiment how its algorithms will flood a teen with triggering and toxic messages in just hours after we created an account. This was glorification of being dangerously underweight, tips on skipping meals, images we could not, in good conscience, show in this room. It's been 2 months, so we've repeated our experiment. On Monday, we created another fake account for a teenager and followed a few accounts promoting eating disorders, and again, within an hour, all of our recommendations promoted pro-anorexia and eating disorder content. 2 months ago, the global head of public safety for Facebook was put on notice by this subcommittee. Nothing has changed. It's all still happening. And in the meantime, more lives have been broken, real lives, with real families and futures, and you hear from them. So, we all know that if Facebook saw a significant threat to its growth or ad revenue, it wouldn't wait 2 months to take action. So why does it take months for Facebook to act when our kids face danger, when time is not on our side? Time is not on our side. So no wonder parents are worried. In fact, parents are furious. They don't trust Instagram, Google, TikTok, and all of their big tech appears. And by the way, this is not an issue limited to Instagram or Facebook. Parents are asking, what is Congress doing to protect our kids? And the resounding bipartisan message from this committee is legislation is coming. We can't rely on trust anymore. We can't rely on self-policing. It's what parents and our children are demanding. Senator Blackburn and I are listening to them, as are other members of committee. We are working together. Your proposal for an industry body asks parents yet again to trust us. We'll do it ourselves. But self-regulation relies on that trust that has been squandered. We need to make sure that the responsibility is on big tech to put a safe product on the market. You can't be allowed to conceal when products are harming kids. So the first imperative is transparency. We need real transparency into these 800-pound gorilla black box algorithms and addictive designs. And disclosure has to include independent, qualified researchers who will then tell the story to the public. We need to update our children's privacy laws. Congress should pass the Bipartisan Children's and Teens Online Privacy Protection Act, authored by Senator Markey, who's here today. I'm proud to be working with him on updating and expanding it. Parents and children need more power and more effective tools to protect themselves on the platform. And that's why Senator Blackburn and I are working on a framework, and we've made good progress to enable that protection. There really should be a duty of care. The United Kingdom has imposed it. It's part of the law there. Why not here? That ought to be part of the framework of legislation that we're considering. Section 230 reform. You make a reference to it in your testimony. The days of absolute broad, unique immunity for big tech are over. And finally, enforcement. State authorities, federal authorities, law enforcement has to be rigorous and strong. So I hope that we will begin the effort of working together, but one way or the other, this committee will move forward. And again, I thank you for being here. I thank all of my colleagues for attending, and I ask for remarks by the ranking member, Senator Blackburn.
And thank you, Senator Blumenthal, and welcome to everyone. We are appreciative that you are here today, Mr. Mosseri. We are grateful for your time and for your testimony. I do want to thank Senator Blumenthal and his team for the work. This is the fifth hearing that we have held dealing with the issues around big tech and the invasions of privacy, the lack of data security, the need for Section 230 reforms, and looking very directly at what these platforms, social media platforms, the effect, the negative and adverse effect that they are having on our children. I will tell you that today I am just a little bit frustrated. I'm frustrated because this is now the fourth time in the past 2 years that we have spoken with someone from Meta, as you are now calling yourselves. And I feel like the conversation continues to repeat itself ad nauseum. And when I go back home to Tennessee, I know that the people there, lots of moms and dads and teachers and pediatricians, they share this frustration because they continue to hear from you that change is coming, that things are going to be different, that there are going to be more tools in the toolbox, that kids are going to be safer online, that privacy is going to be protected, and that data is going to be secure. But guess what? Nothing changes. Nothing. The chairman just talked about what happened with Ms. Davis when she came in and how we pointed all of this out specifically of what we had found. And yet yesterday, what happened? The exact same thing. So I hope that you appreciate the frustration that the American public feels, that they are, they appreciate what the internet can do for them in bringing the world closer. But the applications that you are pushing forward, the social media, the addictive nature, the way this affects children, there is such a frustration that you turn a blind eye toward taking responsibility and accepting accountability for your platform, how you were structured, and how you use the data on these children. Yesterday at 3 a.m., which is midnight in the Silicon Valley, you released a list of product updates that you said would raise the standard for protecting teens and supporting parents online. And I'm not sure what hours you all keep in California, but where I'm from, the middle of the night is when you drop news that you don't want people to see. And maybe you thought that doing it in this manner would keep members of this subcommittee from seeing it right away and from raising concerns, because while I'm sure you know that we fully share the goal of protecting kids and teens online, what we aren't sure about is how the half measures you've introduced are going to get us to the point where we need to be to truly protect teens and young adults online. For example, we know that social media is an integral part of teens' daily lives. According to the Mayo Clinic, 97% of teens between ages 13 and 17 use a social media platform. And 45% say they are online almost constantly. So while telling teens to take a break might seem helpful on the face of things, it's probably not going to get most teenagers to stop doing what they're doing and take a break. Educational tools for parents can be helpful, but frankly, I'm more concerned about the things we know kids and teens are hiding from their parents. We know that Facebook and Instagram have encouraged teens to use secondary accounts and told them to be authentic. And we all remember what it was like to be a teenager. So while parents might gain some insight into what their teens do on their main accounts, what do they do about the accounts they don't even know exist? The ones that Instagram is encouraging them to create. And Instagram announced in July that it would default all teens onto private accounts when they sign up for the site. Yet just yesterday, my team created an account as a 15-year-old girl, and it defaulted to public. So, while Instagram is touting all these safety measures, they aren't even making sure that these safety measures are in effect. For me, this is a case of too little, too late, because now there is bipartisan momentum both here and in the House to tackle these problems we are seeing with big tech. As Senator Blumenthal said, we are working on children's privacy, online privacy, data security, and Section 230 reforms. This is the appropriate time to pass a national consumer privacy bill, as well as kid-specific legislation to keep minors safe online. We also need to give serious thought to how companies like Facebook and Instagram continue to hide behind Section 230's liability shield when it comes to content like human trafficking, sex trafficking, drug trafficking. Despite Congress speaking clearly to this issue when we passed FOSTA and SESTA a few years ago, Mr. Mosseri, there is a lot of work for us to do to improve the online experience and to protect our children and our grandchildren. I think it's best if we do this together, and I look forward to hearing your ideas and your testimony today. Thank you for your appearance.
Thanks, Senator Blackman. I'm pleased to introduce Adam Mosseri. He spent over 11 years at Meta and oversees all functions of the Instagram app, including engineering, product management, and operations. Mr. Mosseri, the floor is yours.
My apologies. Thank you, Senator. Chairman Blumenthal, Ranking Member Blackburn, members of the subcommittee, I'm Adam Mosseri, and I've served as the head of Instagram since 2018. And over the last few months, the subcommittee has held a number of hearings on the safety and well-being of young people online. This is a critically important topic, as you said in your opening statement, and it's something that we think about and work on every day at Instagram. The internet has changed how we all communicate. It's changed how we express ourselves. It's changed how we stay connected to the people that we care about. It's also changed what it's like to be a teenager. Teenagers have always spent time with their friends, developed new interests, and explored their identities. Today, they're doing those things on platforms like Instagram, YouTube, TikTok, and Snapchat. I firmly believe that Instagram and that the internet more broadly can be a positive force in young people's lives. I'm inspired every day by teens on Instagram, and I'm proud that our platform is a place where they can spend time with the people that they care about, where they can start incredible movements, where they can find new interests, where they can even turn a passion into a business. I also know that sometimes young people can come to Instagram dealing with difficult things in their lives. I believe that Instagram can help in those critical moments. It's one of the things that our research has shown, and to me, this is the most important work that we can do. Taking on complex issues like bullying and social comparison and making changes. Now I recognize that many in this room have deep reservations about our company, but I want to assure you that we do have the same goal. We all want teens to be safe online. The internet isn't going away, and I believe there's important work that we can do together, industry and policymakers, to raise the standards across the internet to better serve and protect young people. But the reality is that keeping people safe is not just about any one company. An external survey just last month suggested that more teens are using TikTok and YouTube than Instagram. This is an industry-wide challenge and requires industry-wide solutions and industry-wide standards. Now, we have a specific proposal. We believe there should be an industry body that will determine the best practices when it comes to what I think are the three most important questions with regards to youth safety. How to verify age, how to build age-appropriate experiences, and how to build parental controls. The body should receive input from civil society, from parents, and from regulators. The standards need to be high, and the protections universal. I believe that companies like ours should have to earn some of their Section 230 protections by adhering to those standards. And we've been calling for regulation for nearly 3 years now. And from where I sit, there's no area more important than youth safety. That said, I understand that developing policy takes time, so we're going to continue to push forward on the safety and well-being of young people online. On age verification, we're developing new technologies to address this industry-wide challenge. We're creating a menu of options to allow people to verify that they're old enough to use Instagram that extend beyond simply relying on an ID card. And we're building new technology to proactively find and remove accounts belonging to those under the age of 13. We're also using technology to understand if people are above or below the age of 18 so that we can create a more age-appropriate version of Instagram for them. For example, adults can no longer message people under the age of 18 that don't follow them. And as of this week, we announced that people can no longer tag or mention teens that don't follow them as well. We also provide tools for parents. Parents and guardians know what's best for their teens. And we're launching Instagram's first set of parental controls in March of next year, allowing them to see how much time their teens spend on Instagram and to set time limits. will also give teens a new option to notify their parents if they report someone, giving their parents an opportunity to talk about it with them. As a father of three, I care a great deal about creating an online world that is safe for my children and that allows them to benefit from all the amazing things the internet has to offer. As the head of Instagram, I recognize the gravity of my role in making this happen, not only for my kids, but for generations to come. I'm hopeful that we can work together to reach that goal. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Mosseri. I'll take the first round of questions. Again, we're gonna do 5-minute rounds. A short while ago at our last hearing, TikTok, Snapchat, and YouTube sat at that table and they all committed to making internal research algorithms and data sets about their effect on children and teens available to independent researchers. Will you commit to doing the same?
Senator, we believe it's important to be transparent both with about ranking and algorithms and about data for research. I can commit to you today that we will provide meaningful access to data so that third-party researchers can design their own studies and make their own conclusions about the effects of well-being on young people. And on ranking, I can commit to do all I can to explain how ranking works and to find other ways for us to be transparent about algorithms.
Will you support a legal requirement that independent overseers and researchers not only have access to the data sets, but also check the way algorithms are driving content and recommend changes that you will adopt?
Senator, I'd be happy to have my office work with you on that. I believe that direction is an important one. We do a number of things in this area already. We provide information every month on the effects of our algorithms on removing problematic content from our systems.
Will you commit to a legal requirement that the access be provided and that an independent, separately appointed and separately funded body, not an industry body, as you've suggested, but an independent overseer and researcher have that access?
Senator, on the specifics of how the body works, I'm not a legal expert, but yes, I think there should be requirements and standards for how companies like ours are transparent about both data and algorithms.
Because an industry body is not government regulation that Mark Zuckerberg or others at Facebook and elsewhere have called for. An industry body setting standards is not the same as an independent one. Let me ask you, shouldn't children and parents have the right to report dangerous material and abuse and get a response, get some action? Because we've heard harrowing stories from parents who tried to report and have heard no response. My office made a report and got no response until CNN made the report to press relations. Shouldn't there be an obligation that Instagram will respond?
Senator, yes, I believe we try and respond to all reports, and if we ever fail to do so, that is a mistake that we should correct.
Instagram is addictive. That's the view that has been repeated again and again and again by people who are expert in this field. Parents know it, and for teens who see Instagram's algorithms encouraging, for example, eating disorders, they find it almost impossible to stop. The UK code restricts Instagram's use of addictive design. Legally restricts its use of addictive design. Shouldn't we have a similar rule in the United States?
Senator, respectfully, I don't believe the research suggests that our products are addictive. Research actually shows that on 11 of 12 difficult issues that teens face, teens are struggling, said Instagram helps more than harms. Now, we always care about how people feel about their experiences on our platform, and it's my responsibility as the head of Instagram to do everything I can to help keep people safe, and we're going to continue to do so.
We can debate the meaning of the word addictive, but the fact is that teens who go to the platform find it difficult, maybe sometimes impossible, to stop. And part of the reason is that more content is driven to them to keep them on the site, to aggravate the emotions that are so seductive and ultimately addictive. The UK recognizes it by imposing that design restriction. The same ought to be done in the United States. Let me ask you, will you commit to make the pause on Instagram Kids permanent? In other words, stop developing a site for an app for children under 13.
Senator, the idea of building a version of Instagram for 10 to 12-year-olds was trying to solve a problem. The idea being that we know that 10 to 12-year-olds are online, they want to use platforms like Instagram, and it's difficult for companies like ours to verify age for those that are so young they don't yet have an ID. The hope was to always, or the plan was to always make sure that no child between 10 and 12 had access to any version of Instagram, even one that was designed for them, without their parents' consent. And so what I can commit to today is that no child between the ages of 10 and 12, should we ever manage to build Instagram for 10 to 12-year-olds, will have access to that without their explicit parental consent.
I have more questions. My time has expired. I thank you for answering my questions, Ms. Mosseri. Senator Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staying on Instagram Kids for a moment, I know you were doing research into 8-year-olds and pulling together data on 8-year-olds, and I assume that was in relation to Instagram Kids. So are you still doing research on children under age 13?
Sorry, making sure the mic is on. Senator, I don't believe we ever did any research with 8-year-olds for Instagram Kids, and neither are we doing that today. We've entirely paused the project.
Okay. And then if you were to completely remove that project, who would make that decision?
Senator, it was my decision to pause Instagram Kids.
Okay, it would be your decision to just do away with it?
Senator, I'm responsible for Instagram, okay. So yes, it would be my decision.
Okay, let's talk about Jane Doe versus Facebook.
Senator, what?
Jane Doe versus Facebook.
Apologies.
Okay, I assume you can't get into the details of that because the Supreme Court is still deciding whether or not to take that case. But the petition, which alleges that Facebook enabled the trafficking of a minor on its platform, really raises some very serious questions and concerns about what we're seeing and how people are using Instagram. So do you prohibit known sex offenders from creating Instagram accounts?
Senator, human trafficking and any exploitation of children is abhorrent, and we don't allow it on our platforms.
Okay, do you require minors to link their accounts to a parent or guardian's account?
Senator, no.
You don't.
If you're over the age of 13, you can sign up for an Instagram account. But we do believe that parental controls are incredibly important, which is why we're launching our first version in March of next year.
Okay. You know, yes, the controls are going to be vitally important, but an industry group is not going to give the controls that are needed, and probably not even an independent group. That is why we'll do something with federal statute. Also, I think it would be interesting to know how many people that are in human trafficking, sex trafficking, and drug trafficking that have been indicted or convicted that were using Instagram. Could you all provide that number for us?
Senator, I'd be happy to talk to the team and get back
to you. That would be excellent. My staff created an Instagram account for a 15-year-old girl, and it defaulted to public. I mentioned that earlier. Isn't the opposite supposed to happen, and have you considered turning off the public option altogether for minor accounts?
Senator, I appreciate the question. I learned of that just this morning. It turns out that though we default those under the age of 16 to private accounts for the vast majority of accounts, which are created on Android and iOS, we have missed that on the web, and we will correct that quickly.
Okay. Also, when they created this account, it defaulted to this statement: include your account when recommending similar accounts people might want to follow. Is this a feature that should remain on by default for minors?
Senator, we think it's important that no matter what your age, it's easy for you to find accounts that you're interested in?
Even if you're under 18.
Senator, I believe teenagers too have interests, and that should be easy for them to find
teenagers
those interests.
Teenagers have interest, yes. But what we're trying to address are the adverse and negative effects that are happening to children because they are on your platform. Can adults not labeled as suspicious by you still find, follow, and message minors?
Senator, if your account is private, if someone follows you, you have to approve it. So adults can ask to follow you, but you have the decision or the ability to decide whether or not they're allowed to.
Okay. In your testimony, you said you removed more than 850,000 accounts because they did not meet your minimum age requirement. These accounts were disabled because the users did not provide identification showing that they were at least 13 years old. So why did you say you didn't want to know when JoJo Siwa said she had been on Instagram since she was 8 years old? Is that your general attitude toward kids who are on your platform?
Absolutely not, Senator. We invest a lot to try to identify those under the age of 13, and whenever we find them,
okay,
we remove.
At that moment, when you responded to her that you did not want to know, why didn't you use that as a teaching moment?
Senator, I would say it was a missed opportunity.
Indeed, it was a missed opportunity, and it sends the wrong message. It looked as if you were encouraging kids that want to be online stars to get on earlier and to build their audience. This is a part of our frustration with you, with Instagram, and with these platforms. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Senator Blackburn. Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you. Mr. Mosseri, I'm looking at this from a perspective of parents, and I guess I'll talk to parents, since so many of them have told me that they have done everything they can to try to get their kids off your product, kids who are addicted at age 10. And they are scared for their kids. They want their kids to do their homework and not get addicted to Instagram. And yet we then find out that what your company did was to increase your marketing budget to try to woo more teens from 67 million in 2018 to $390 million focused on kids this year. And so when I hear you're going to suddenly, with all your technological wizards, develop some kind of new way to check to see if really young kids are on there, you could have been spending this money, $390 million, to do that for years. You have the money to do it. I think that we are in diametrically opposed goals, the goals of parents out there and the goals of your company. Our kids aren't cash cows, and that is exactly what's been going on. Because when you look at the marketing budget and you look at what your company has done, it's to try to get more and more of them on board. And when I look at your company's quotes from one document, you, not you personally, but your company viewed losing teen users as a, quote, existential threat, whereas parents are viewing their kids' addictions to your product and other products as an existential threat to their families. So my first question is that, in fact, the truth that you've been increasing money, advertising money, to woo more teen kids onto your platform?
Senator, no, I don't believe those statistics are correct. We increased our overall marketing budget between last year and this year, but it was not, I think as you characterized it, as the majority of it was focused on teens, and that's not true.
Okay, so do you view the kids as a feeder way for people to get into your product? Have you not done things to get more teenagers interested in your product? Are you not worried about losing them to other platforms? You better tell the truth. You're under oath.
Absolutely, Senator. Senator, we try and make Instagram as relevant as possible for people of all ages, including teens. Teens do amazing things on Instagram every day. But we also invest, I believe, more than anyone else in keeping people, including teens, safe. We will spend around $5 billion this year alone, and we have over 40,000 people working on safety and integrity at the company.
And do you think 3 hours a day is an appropriate amount of time for kids to spend on Instagram?
Senator,
I'm asking this because just when you put out those new rules, that was an option for parents, 3 hours a day. Is that a good use of kids' time?
Senator, I appreciate the question.
And it was in your safety tools that you just put out there. The first option given to kids, to parents, was 3 hours a day.
Senator.
I have them. Can I put them on the record?
Sorry.
Mr. Chair, thank you.
If I may, Senator, I'm a parent, and I can understand that parents have concerns about how much screen time their kids have. I think every parent feels that way. I ultimately think that it's a parent, that a parent knows best what's best for their teen. So the appropriate amount of time should be a decision by a parent about the specific teen. If one parent wants to set that limit at 10 minutes and another parent wants to set that limit at 3 hours, who am I to say that they don't know what's best for their children?
And do you believe your company has invested enough in identifying that young children are not on the platform when you know that they're not supposed to be on there, and making sure you're registering and using all your technology, not to just increase your profits, but to make sure the kids aren't on there? You think you've done enough?
Senator, two things. One, yes, I believe that we've invested more than anyone else, but I also believe that it's still a very challenging industry-wide issue. I think there's a number of things that we can do at the industry level to better verify age. Specifically, I believe it would be much more effective to have age verification at the device level, have a parent who gives their 14-year-old a device tell the phone that their child is 14, as opposed to having every app, and there's millions of apps out there, trying to verify age on their own. That should happen at the device level. We understand that might not happen, or that might take time, and in the meantime, we're going to invest heavily in getting more sophisticated and how we identify the age of people under the age of 18.
And is it true that someone in your company said that it was an existential threat if you lost teen users?
Senator, I don't...
Is that true or not? Because we have a document that said that.
Senator, I assume that's true.
Okay. So you understand what we're thinking up here when it's our job to protect kids, and we have parent after parent calling our office, emailing us. One of the parents likened to me that it was like a water faucet going off and it was overflowing, and she's sitting there with a mop trying to figure out how to use all of the tools you give them that she can't figure out how to use. So I think at some point the accountability is on you guys. And that means everything from the privacy bills to expanding the child protections online to the competition policy. Because maybe if we had actual competition in this country instead of Meta owning you and owning most of the platforms and most of the back and forth for kids, maybe we could have another platform developed that would have the privacy protections that you have not been able to develop in terms of keeping teens off your platform that aren't even old enough to be on there. So that's what I think, some food for thought for all of you, is the opposition to some of the competition policy, capitalism, pro-capitalism ideas that we have over in judiciary, and I'll hand it back to our chair.
Thank you, Senator Klobuchar. Thanks for your work, your leadership on this issue here and on the Judiciary Committee, where we're on the Subcommittee on Antitrust, which you chair. I will ask a couple of questions because we have a vote ongoing, so a number of my colleagues will be returning from the floor. You know, your suggestion for tech companies to earn Section 230 protection has a certain appeal to me, since I'm the author of the Earn It Act, along with Senator Graham. It's also the concept that underlies other proposals that we've made, but that's not government regulation. So the question is, will you support the UK's Children's Code that Instagram has to obey in the UK? Shouldn't kids in the United States have protection as good as the kids in UK enjoy?
Absolutely, Senator. A few quick things. One is, I believe that is the age-appropriate design. I'm forgetting the last letter of the acronym. And I believe it's something that we support. And we support safety standards for kids everywhere, including here in the U.S. I'd also, if you would indulge me for a minute, like to clarify that my proposal is, yes, an industry body that sets standards for youth safety with input from civil society, from policymakers, and from parents, but one that once those standards are proposed, they would be approved by policymakers like yourself. And I also believe that policymakers or regulators should make the decision of whether or not any individual company, like mine, is adhering to those standards. So it's not simply self-regulation.
And then enforce them? Bring lawsuits? Seek damages?
Senator, we believe that a strong incentive would be to tie some of the Section 230 protections to adherence, and that could be a decision by regulators.
So would the Attorney General of the United States or the Attorney General of a state, like Connecticut, where I was Attorney General, have the power to enforce those standards?
Senator, we believe in enforcement. Specifically, how to implement that enforcement is something that we would like to work with your office on and other offices as well.
Well, that's a simple yes or no. Enforceability has to be part of your proposal.
Senator, I agree. Enforceability is incredibly important. Without enforcement, it's just words.
So you think that the Attorney General of the United States could enforce those standards, which means they would be written in the statute?
Senator, I don't know, because I'm not a legal expert, if the best way to enforce it would be with the Attorney General. But in general, I think it should happen at the federal level, and it's something that I'd be happy to have my team work with.
Would you favor private rights of action, so individuals who are harmed could bring an action against Meta?
Senator, I believe that it's important that companies like ours are held accountable to high standards, but I believe the most important way or the most effective way of doing so is to define industry standards and best practices at the federal level, ideally, and to seek enforcement, as you suggest.
These are really yes or no questions. They're pretty clear, and I know you are knowledgeable about them. So I hope you will answer them more clearly in the answers that you provide in writing. I'm going to yield to Senator
Klobuchar. And I can do this on the record, but I did want to, since you denied this idea that the marketing budget went from $67 million to $390 million and that much of the budget was allocated to wooing teens. That was reported on by the New York Times from internal documents from your company. So do you still deny that this is the fact?
Senator, occasionally there are reports that are inaccurate. In this case, I believe that report or that article said that the majority of our budget was focused on teens, and I know for a fact that that was not the case.
Much of the budget, is that accurate?
Senator, I don't remember off the top of my head.
Then could you give me the number of what percentage of the budget was focused on teens? You must, as a business, be able to break it down that way. So that would be helpful. I'll ask that in writing.
I'd be happy to follow up with
you
on that.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Markey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks to your leadership, Mr. Chairman, we have Francis Haugen, who has told us quite clearly that 32% of teen girls say that when they feel bad about their bodies, Instagram makes them feel worse. And 6% of American teen users trace their desire to kill themselves to Instagram. That's your own research, Mr. Mosseri. Yet faced with these frightening findings, did Facebook back off its efforts to target children? No, just the opposite. Facebook pursued plans to launch a version of the platform for even younger users, Instagram Kids, and that is appalling. Mr. Mosseri, I'm glad Facebook has heeded my calls and paused these plans, but you have since publicly doubled down on Instagram Kids and said it is, quote, the right thing to do. Your statement makes crystal clear that self-regulation is not an option for parents and children in the United States of America. Instagram sees a dollar sign when it sees kids. Parents should see a stop sign when it sees Instagram. Mr. Mosseri, do you support my bipartisan legislation with Senator Blumenthal, Senator Cassidy, Senator Lummis to update the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act and give 13, 14, and 15-year-olds control over their data? Yes or no?
Senator, respectfully, it's important that we're clear on what the research actually shows. Any loss of life to suicide or to anything, any other reason is a tragedy, but that was 6% numbers inaccurate. It was 1% of teens would trace their thoughts back. Now, anybody feeling worse about themselves is something that we take incredibly seriously. Now, you asked if I support the specific act you're proposing. I do strongly support federal regulation, not industry regulation, when it comes to youth safety. That said, if you move the age from 13 to 16, we know that 14 and 15-year-olds also want to be online. They also can lie about their age, and you're going to make the challenge of age verification even more difficult. That said, I do believe that 13 isn't a magic number. People's needs as they grow up evolve, and we should build age-appropriate experiences based on children's age.
So will you give 13 to 15-year-olds the right to have all of their information expunged?
Senator,
that is being gathered online. Do you support legislation that would give parents and children the ability to have their records expunged?
Senator, you can already delete your account and all of your data. You should have that right, whether or not you're a teenager
or an adult. Would you support national legislation that mandates that each parent and child be given the ability to expunge it?
Senator,
would you support legislation to do that, make it mandatory?
Senator, I would support legislation that required companies like ours to allow people to delete their data, yes.
Yeah, okay. And just to make that a permanent protection that's on the books. Would you support legislation to ban targeted ads towards children?
Senator,
towards teens and children.
Senator, we believe that anyone should always have an age-appropriate experience on Instagram or on any social platform, and that extends to ads. We have different rules for ads on Instagram and on Facebook. We only allow advertisers to target based on age, based on gender, and based on location. And we don't allow certain types of ads, things like weight loss ads and dating ads for those under the age of 18, or alcohol-related ads for those under the age of 21.
So do you support legislation that would ban targeting of ads to children, yes or no?
Senator, I believe it's valuable for ads to be relevant, but I do believe that some measures need to be taken to keep children safe, which is why I would support something in the direction of what we do, which is to limit the targeting abilities of platforms.
Yeah. Well, again, yes or no, mandate or no mandate? That's the question. It's exactly why we have to make sure that Facebook and Instagram don't reserve the right to be able to target these kids. Yes or no?
Senator, I'm trying to be specific about what I would support, which is what we build, which is limited targeting options.
I just keep coming back to the fact that your answers are too vague to make it possible for us to make these decisions in an informed legislative way, and to do so in the very near future, which is what I think we have to do. The chilling truth, unfortunately, continues just to be that in the absence of regulation, that big tech has become a threat to our democracy, our society, and to the children in our country. And let's just be clear, Facebook, which owns Instagram, opposes regulation. Your idea of regulation is an industry group creating standards that your company follows. That's self-regulation, that's status quo, and that just won't cut it post the revelations that this subcommittee has made public. We do need laws. We need laws passed by this body. We have to ban targeted ads. We have to make sure that that is the law in our country. Everything that this subcommittee has unveiled continues to make that a necessity, including the testimony that you are delivering today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Senator Markey. Senator Baldwin.
So I missed just a segment as I went over to vote, and it may have come up because this is work I did with Senator Klobuchar. I joined Senators Klobuchar and Capito in writing to Meta for more information about how Instagram is combating eating disorder content and the harms it brings to users, particularly young people. In response to our question about how the platform is working to remove this content, Meta indicated that it uses a combination, I'm quoting now from the letter, a combination of reports from our community, human review, and artificial intelligence, close quote, to find and take down material that violates your terms of service. The response further notes that there are more than 15,000 human reviewers on staff. I also met with Frances Haugen, the former Facebook employee whose disclosures has spurred this series of hearings. And when I asked her about what more Instagram could do to remove content like this, content glorifying eating disorders, she argued that more human review is really the key. According to her, many community reports simply are not investigated, and artificial intelligence cannot successfully identify patterns, networks, and distribution points for problematic content. Given that Meta's platforms, according to your own data, have 3.6 billion monthly active users, the 15,000 reviewers would seem to pale in comparison to the amount of content those 3.6 billion monthly active users could post. So do you agree that more human reviewers will help you move more successfully removing problematic content more quickly? And if so, will your company commit to strengthening its investment in human review?
Senator, thank you for the question. We have over 40,000 people, human reviewers and otherwise, and engineers who work on safety and integrity. And we are investing about $5 billion this year. At a high level, people are better at nuance, and technology is often better at scale. I think the most effective thing we can do, not only for eating disorder content, which is tragic and a complicated societal issue, is to invest more, particularly on the technology side, but in both. We're going to continue to do so.
Let me ask, I know that this hearing is focused mostly on youth and harmful, but how many countries is Instagram available?
Senator, Instagram is available in over 70 languages. I unfortunately don't know the number of countries off the top of my head, but I'd be happy to get back to you with that number.
Okay, so 70 languages, that's the point I was going to get to. Of those 40,000 or 15,000, which is what was in the, I think, the letter response, how many are language-specific sort of monitoring content in each of those 70 languages?
Thank you, Senator. Actually, I misspoke. We review content in 70 languages. We have even more languages that people speak that use Instagram, and we're always looking to increase the number that we cover. I apologize for the mistake.
Okay. So there are gaps, then, in terms of human review in those areas.
Senator, we're always looking to improve, not only through language coverage, but through building more accurate classifiers, through improving the efficiency of our reviewers, because it helps keep people more safe.
I may have some follow-ups with regard to that are more specific, but we also all know that there is tremendous social pressure for kids to utilize social media platforms and services. And while it is the industry standard to block or restrict access to those younger than 13, we know that younger teens and tweens are still signing up for social media accounts. I appreciate that your company decided to press pause on its proposed service focused on younger kids earlier this year. I understand from your announcement yesterday that Meta is looking to introduce new parent controls and other tools for Instagram in the coming months. But I'm concerned about what you are doing today to keep kids under 13 off the platform. So tell me a little bit more about what you're doing to strengthen age verification and why, given the problems of which you're already well aware, with Instagram and Meta's experience with other services focused on younger kids like Messenger Kids, why have you waited to institute more parental controls or other steps protecting young users?
Senator, on the parental controls question, I believe As a parent, it's going to be more responsible to develop an age-appropriate version of Instagram for those under 13. But I paused that project, and I took the exact work they were building, which was parental controls, because no one was going to have access unless they had their parents' consent. And we pivoted that to teens, because 13 isn't a magical number. Now, you also asked, how do we verify the age of those under 13? It's difficult, given that young people of that age don't have an ID in most countries. We build what we call classifiers, which try to predict age, and then we ask people to prove their age if it looks like they might be too young. We look at things like, in certain countries, you know, sweet 16 is a cultural norm here in the U.S. And so we look for, do people say that on someone's birthday, and does that line up with the age that they set? And we get better over time as we get more signals, but it's, I want to be very clear, it's not perfect, which is why I believe there are better industry-wide ways to solve age verification, because it really is an industry challenge. It is not unique to Facebook or to Instagram.
Thank you. Chairman Blumenthal will be back from his vote in a moment. We're going to be starting our second round. We have some other members that are coming for their first round. In the meantime, I want to return to a question I asked you about those that are human traffickers, sex traffickers, drug traffickers, their utilization of your site. Now, I know that in 2020, you sent over 21 million sex abuse images on your platform. Facebook sent these, and you sent these to NCMEC. So I thank you for doing that. That's the right thing to do. I'm interested to know whether these child exploitation images and reports, if in your reports, do you include traffickers? And do you include those violations when you make that report to NCMEC with these images?
Senator, I'd have to check on that specific and get back to you, but we do allow you to report an image or a photo for violating any of our standards, and you can see how well we are at reducing the prevalence of those problems in our consumer.
Then get back to us and let us know if you are also reporting these individuals that are posting and sharing these sexual abuse images of children. Senator, Thune, you're
Senator.
Recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thanks for holding today's hearing. The lack of transparency from big tech companies and the effect these companies have on consumers is concerning to the public, and rightfully so. Because of the secrecy with which big tech protects their algorithms and content moderation practices, we have little idea how these companies use algorithms to amplify or suppress content, or how they can affect the behavior of users without their knowledge. Tomorrow, the Communications Subcommittee, on which I serve as ranking member, will take a closer look at the effects of this persuasive technology, and I look forward to hearing from the panel about the details of how algorithms and artificial intelligence are designed and deployed on internet platforms to manipulate users, as well as the bigger picture about what the future might hold for us when corporations and governments know more information about each of us than we know about ourselves. We must find ways to improve more transparency and accountability into the algorithms deployed on internet platforms that select the content that billions of people see every day. Since hearing from the Facebook whistleblower, we now have more insight into Instagram and Facebook's troubling practices with regard to how it uses algorithms. And in my view, it's long past time for Congress to enact legislation to ensure that these companies are held accountable. There's also bipartisan support for shedding more light on the secretive content moderation processes big tech uses, and to provide consumers more options when engaging with internet platforms, which is why I've introduced two bipartisan bills to address these issues, the PACT Act and the Filter Bubble Transparency Act. And I look forward in the time that I have to discussing these issues with you today, Mr. Mosseri. And let me start by just asking, does Instagram use persuasive technology, meaning technology that is designed to change people's attitudes and behaviors?
Senator, I've worked on ranking and algorithms for years, and that's not how we work. We use ranking to try and connect people with the friends that they find meaningful, and we use them to try and keep people safe.
The Wall Street Journal revealed that Instagram often ignored warnings about the harmful impact the platform had on users, particularly young girls. With that being said, do you believe consumers should be able to use Instagram without being manipulated by algorithms that are designed to keep them hooked on the platform? And would you support giving consumers more options when engaging on Instagram's platform? For instance, providing consumers a feed that's not being fed to them by algorithms or that is in a chronological order.
Senator, I believe it's important that people have control of their experience. So yes, I would support giving people the option to have a chronological feed.
On the issue of Section 230 reform, Senator Schatz and I have introduced legislation that would, among other things, require platforms like Instagram to provide for more due process to users regarding their moderation and censorship practices and submit public transparency reports about content that has been removed or de-emphasized. Do you believe this provision would help build trust with Instagram's users?
Senator, we believe in more transparency and accountability, and we believe in more control. That's why we're currently working on a version of a chronological feed that we hope to launch next year. That's why we provide a number of ways for you to see how content moderation works on the platform. So for instance, today you can go to the account center, I believe it's called account status, and see any of your content that has been taken down. And that's why we're working on more ways to give people more control over their experience and create more transparency about how Instagram works.
Do you believe that algorithm explanation or algorithm transparency are appropriate policy responses?
I believe very strongly in algorithmic transparency. I think it'd be hard for you to find someone who's tried as much to explain how ranking works. There's a number of ways to be transparent. I think in some cases, the most effective is to look at the output of algorithms like we do in our community guidelines enforcement report. And in other cases, it's more appropriate to explain how they work instead of releasing millions of lines of code. Apologies.
And could you just elaborate a little bit on when you talk about giving consumers a feed that's not being fed to them by an algorithm or that is in a chronological order? You said that you're going to implement that that policy beginning next year. How do you came to that decision? And sort of more specifically, what the dates for that implementation, and maybe if you could elaborate a little bit on just exactly what that might look like.
Absolutely, Senator. So we've been focused for a few years now on how to give people more control over their experience. One idea that we've experimented with publicly is called favorites, where you can pick a subset of people you want to have show up at the top of feed. Another we've been working on for months now is a chronological version of Instagram. I wish I had a specific month to tell you right now, but right now we're targeting the first quarter of next year.
Okay. And we would like to take what you're proposing to do and codify it, and that's what the Filter Bubble Act does. Thank you, Madam.
Senator Lujan, you're recognized.
Thank you very much, Chair Blackburn, and want to thank everyone for calling this important hearing as well to our chair and to our ranking member. Tomorrow, I'll also be convening a hearing titled Disrupting Dangerous Algorithms, Addressing the Harms of Persuasive Technology in the Communications, Media, and Broadband Subcommittee, where we'll discuss legislative solutions to online amplification of content that spreads misinformation, threatens the mental and physical well-being of our children, and promotes extremism. One of the lines of questions that I had today based on questions that came before from other colleagues earlier in this important hearing lies around data retention and deletion. And I think there was a line of questioning even now from one of my colleagues as well. Does Instagram have in place practices to abide by the principle of data minimization, especially for sensitive personal information?
Yes, Senator.
Can you provide those to the committee?
Senator, I'd be happy to follow up with that.
That's a yes?
Senator, yes. I'll get the exact details on what we do and follow up with the committee.
Appreciate that. How long does Instagram store data related to what websites users visit and what internal links they click from inside the app?
Senator, I apologize. I do not know that offhand, but again, I'd be happy to get back to you with the specifics there.
Do you know how long Instagram stores location information for a user?
Senator, if you post a photo that has a location, it'll say that location on that photo, so that'll be stored for as long as that photo is up. In other cases, I assume we have retention policies that are quite short. We'll get back to you with the specifics, but it'll depend on the usage of location data.
When was the last time Instagram reviewed and updated its data decision, deletion, and retention policies.
Senator, we operate as one company, so it would be for both Instagram and Facebook. So we wouldn't have, there wouldn't be a specific retention policy for Instagram. I don't know the last time the policies were specifically updated, but I can tell you that we're constantly working on privacy, making sure that we can do more to empower people to protect their own data, and making sure that we're compliant with the increasing number of privacy regulations around the world.
Would you support federal policy legislation that enforces data retention limits and data deletion requirements?
Senator, not only would we support that, we believe it's important for there to be privacy regulation here in the U.S., and that's something that we've been very public about for years now.
When users request to download their data from Instagram, are users given all information that the company holds on them, including assumptions that the company has about them based on their behavior?
Senator, when you download your data, we give you everything that is associated with you, as far as I know, but I want to make sure I double check that. There are certain instances where, actually, I can't think of any exceptions, but I'll get back to you.
So the other way that I would ask that question, that maybe it requires follow-up, is there any information that Instagram does not share with users when they request their data?
Senator, we do our best to share all the data, or all your data, when you ask to download your data. As we add new features, we add them to what we call download your data to make sure that you have all the data.
Instagram has the option for users to request to delete their data that Instagram holds. Is that correct?
Yes. And if you delete your account, we can delete your data if you request it.
Is there any data that Instagram holds from a user after a user deletes their information?
Not that I know of, Senator, no.
Is that something you can get back to me on as well?
Absolutely, but I can also assure you that we do all we can to delete all your data if you ask us to. To do otherwise would be incredibly problematic.
I appreciate that. There was a question that I asked Mr. Zuckerberg back in 2017 about Facebook's collection behavior about non-users, to which he responded to me that Facebook did not collect non-user information. Facebook, about a week later, released a correction to that, where Mr. Zuckerberg must have been mistaken or had a lapse in how he responded to that particular question. But nonetheless, I really want to get to the bottom of that, especially with the rampant collection of data from individuals as well. And then the last question, Madam Chair, that I'll submit into the record, because I'm out of time now, is the work that has to be done in non-English language disinformation and misinformation. It's a huge problem. I think it's important for Facebook, for Instagram, and Meta. I get confused with which term I should be using here with rebranding. I guess I'm not so good with it, but
I'm comfortable with any term you would prefer.
That we're able to get disaggregated data, as we requested in this hearing, from a Facebook witness, and we still have not been responded to. And I think it's very important for the committee's wishes to be respected, which were done in a bipartisan way.
Senator, I appreciate that point. Since we talked about that the other day, I've started to look into that. There are a number of ways we might be able to break out data around our community standards enforcement policy. It's possible. One possibility is what language the content is in. Another possibility is what language the person who sees that content speaks. Another possibility is what country. And so we're going to get back to you on what we think is the most efficient and that's responsible thing we can do in this space. And I'll personally make sure that we do that and get back to you promptly.
Thanks, Senator Lujan. Senator Lee.
Mr. Mosseri, does Instagram advocate weight loss or plastic surgery for teenage girls under the age of 18?
Sorry, Senator, I apologize. I missed the second word of your question. Does it have a what?
Does Instagram advocate for, does it recommend weight loss or plastic surgery for girls under the age of 18?
Absolutely not. We don't recommend an eating disorder-related content to people of any age.
Very glad to hear that. I beg to differ here. Leading up to this hearing, I've heard about a lot of complaints from people across Utah and elsewhere. who have told me about inappropriate content available through the Explore page on Instagram, available specifically to children. And so I was encouraged to see, to look into it myself. So I had my staff create a fictitious 13-year-old account for a fictitious 13-year-old girl. The Explore page yielded fairly benign results at first, when all we did was create the account, knowing that it was a 13-year-old girl. But Instagram also provided that same account for this fake 13-year-old that included some recommendations, a list of recommendations of accounts that we should follow, including multiple celebrities and influencers. So we followed the first count, the first account that was recommended by Instagram, which happened to be a very famous female celebrity. Now, after following that account, we went back to the Explore page, and the content quickly changed. You see, right at first, all that came up when we opened up the account were some fairly benign hairstyling videos. But that's not what we saw after we followed this account, the account that was recommended by Instagram itself. And it expanded into all sorts of stuff, including content that was full of unrealistic standards for women, including plastic surgery and commentary on women's height, content that could be detrimental to the self-image of any 13-year-old girl. If you need any kind of evidence on the kinds of harms that this can produce, you can look to the report that I recently issued through my Joint Economic Committee team, specifically on this topic last week. So, Mr. Mosseri, why did following Instagram's top recommended account for a 13-year-old girl cause our Explore page to go from showing really innocuous things like hairstyling videos to content that promotes body dysmorphia, sexualization of women, and content otherwise unsuitable for a 13-year-old girl? What happened?
Senator, eating disorder related content and eating disorders more broadly are a very complicated and difficult issue in society without...
And they're complicated enough without a social media site recommending it.
Senator, we know that I've personally spoken to teens in multiple countries around the world that use Instagram to get support when suffering from things like eating disorders. We absolutely do not want any content that promotes eating disorders on our platform. We do our best to remove it. I believe, and I'll get back to it, the specific stat, it's roughly 5 in every 10,000 things viewed. And my responsibility as the head of Instagram is to get to that number to as close to zero as possible. But we believe that every company, Snapchat, TikTok, YouTube, should be public like we are about exactly what the prevalence of important content problems are on our platform.
Right. I get that. And I can only take your word for it here. I understand what you're saying about the overall numbers. That's not how it appeared on this account. That's not how it happened at all. It was hairstyling videos and innocuous stuff one minute. The next minute, after we followed a famous female celebrity, it changed and it went dark fast. It was not 5 in 1,000 or 5 in 10,000. It was rampant. The thing that gets me is, what changed was following this female celebrity account, and that female celebrity account was recommended to this 13-year-old girl. So why are you recommending that somebody follow a site with the understanding that by doing that, you're exposing that girl to all sorts of other things that are not suitable for any child?
Senator, I appreciate the question because it is an incredibly important and difficult space. If we recommended something that we shouldn't have, I'm accountable for that. I'm the head of Instagram. But you said a second ago you have to take my word for it, and I don't believe you should. Our first community standards enforcement report, sorry, we've been doing it for years, but this quarter we're in right now, is going to be independently audited by Ernst & Young, and we're committed to doing independent audits going forward.
That's great, and I've independently audited myself, and what I'm saying to you is I'll take your word for it as to the 5 in 1,000 or 5 in 10,000 point. What I'm saying is it was decidedly not 5 in 1,000 or 5 in 10,000 on this page for this poor, unsuspecting, albeit fake, 13-year-old girl.
Senator.
That's a concern. Look, I'm running out of time.
but I'm also running out of patience from a company that has told us over and over and over again, we're so concerned about your children. We're so concerned. We're commissioning a blue ribbon study to be done, or we're doing a review, and stuff like this is still happening. Meanwhile, the Tech Transparency Project, TDP, recently conducted another experiment. It demonstrated how minors can use their Instagram accounts to search for prescription and illicit drugs and connect with drug dealers. In fact, according to TDP, it only took two clicks, to find drug dealers on that platform. So why are children's accounts even allowed to search for drug content to begin with, much less allowed to do so in a way that leads them to a drug dealer in two clicks?
Senator, accounts selling drugs or any other regulated goods are not allowed on the platform.
Apparently they are.
Senator, respectfully, I don't think you can take one or two examples and indicate that that is indicative of what happens on the platform more broadly, which is why, and I want to be clear here.
Two clicks. It only took two clicks.
Senator, I'm not familiar with that specific report. I'm more than happy to look into it. I do want to be clear, though, because I've been talking about the Community Standards Enforcement Report a lot. And I know it sounds like numbers. And I know behind every one of those numbers is a person who's experiencing something difficult. So I don't want to sound callous in any way. So if there's room for us to improve, I embrace that. That's why we invest more than, I believe, anybody else, $5 billion this year, over 40,000 people. That's why we believe in industry standards and industry accountability. And that's why we are calling on the entire industry, YouTube, TikTok, Snapchat, to come together to set industry standards that are approved by regulators, like here in the US, in order to make the internet more safer for not only kids online, but for everyone.
There's a scene from the movie Monty Python and the Search for the Holy Grail. There's a big fight. Somebody concludes the discussion by saying, look, let's not bicker and argue about who killed who here. I think we have to reach the point where we realize some real bad stuff is happening. And you're the new tobacco, whether you like it or not, and you've got to stop selling the tobacco, in quotation marks, to kids. Don't let them have it. Don't give it to them. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Lee. Senator Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this important hearing and a series of hearings that you and the ranking member have been holding. Mr. Marset, have you read the Surgeon General's report that he issued yesterday, Protecting Youth Mental Health?
Senator, I've started to read it. I haven't quite finished it. From what I've read so far, it makes it clear that teens in this country are struggling, particularly with...
Yeah, let me... I'll get into it a little bit.
Yes, Senator.
I agree. Very sobering reading. It mentions in 2021... emergency room visits for suicide attempts by adolescent girls are up 51%. 51%. I mean, that's just shocking. And the Surgeon General said our obligation is to act. It's not just medical, it's moral. So the way I've read it, it's kind of a witch's brew of two things that are driving so much of these horrendous statistics related to mental health and suicide. It's been the pandemic and the negative impacts of social media. That's in the report. One of the recommendations from the Surgeon General is limiting social media usage. Do you agree with that?
Senator, I'll answer that question, but first, I want to be clear that I don't believe the research shows that social media is driving the rise in suicides.
Why do you think the Surgeon General of the United States, who just issued a 53-page report on mental health and teen suicides, said that we should limit social media to help get out of this crisis?
Senator, from what I've read of the Surgeon General's report so far, it's about a number of different issues, not just suicides. So to make a connection between one problem that he talks about And one of the recommendations he makes, I think, is a bit of a leap.
Let me ask my question again. The Surgeon General of the United States makes as one of his recommendations to address what clearly is a mental health crisis for teenagers, particularly teenage girls in America. One of his recommendations is to limit social media usage. So do you agree with it?
Senator, two things. One, just
answer
yes,
the question.
Senator, I believe parents should be able to set limits for their children because I believe a parent knows best, which is why we've developed, or why we are currently developing, parental controls that let parents not only see how much time their teens spend on Instagram, but set limits.
Let me just add, I mean, this is a really important question because if we have experts saying we need to limit social media usage, which is what the Surgeon General just said yesterday, to help address mental health issues, does that go against the business model of Instagram or Facebook or Meta? Isn't your business model to get more eyeballs for a longer time on social media? Isn't that what you're about?
Senator, if people don't feel good about the time that they spend on our platform, if for any other reason people want to spend less time on our platform, I have to believe that it's better for our business over the long run.
But do you make more money when people spend more time on your platform or less?
Senator, on average, we make more money when people spend more time on our platform because we're an advertising business.
Right. So, but you agree with the Surgeon General that people should limit their social media usage? My point is they seem to be in direct contradiction with each other. What the Surgeon General is saying, we need to better the health of our young Americans, and what your basic business model proposition is. They seem to be actually colliding with each other.
Senator, respectfully, I disagree. I think the important thing is to distinguish between the short term and the long term. Over the long run, it has to be better for us as a business for people to feel good about the time that they spend on our platform. It has to be better for us as a business for parents to not only have a meaningful amount of control, but be able to exercise that control over how their teens spend on how much time their teams spend on our platform. And so we take a very long view on this, which
is
why.
Do you have internal data relating to mental health and suicide usage on your platform or Facebook or Meta?
Senator, we do research to make Instagram better and safer. And as a parent, that's exactly what I would want. I believe we lead the industry and do more than anyone else on suicide.
You're not answering my question. Do you have internal data related to the issue of teen suicide and usage of your platform?
Senator, I'm not sure I exactly understand your question specifically, but yes, we do research and we talk to third-party experts and academics about difficult issues like suicide, which has inspired work like not allowing any content that talks about the methods of suicide, connecting people who seek out that type of content with expert-backed resources, and if someone looks like they're at risk of hurting themselves, proactively reaching to local emergency services on their behalf, not only here in the U.S., but in a number of countries around the world.
Mr. Chairman, I'm just one final question. Can I ask very quickly, I looked into a little bit of this issue of your announcement on Instagram for kids, and just that phrase kind of makes me nervous. It sounds like a gateway drug to more usage. Why did you put a pause on that? And are you going to permanently pause that? And do you worry that you're going to get now kids hooked on more usage with Instagram for kids?
Senator, the idea was trying to solve a problem. We know that 10 to 12-year-olds are online. The average age, I believe, when you get a cell phone in this country is currently 11 or 10. We know that they want to be on platforms like Instagram, and Instagram, quite frankly, wasn't designed for them. So the idea was to give parents the option to give their child an age-appropriate version of Instagram that where they could control not only how much time that they spent, but who they could interact with and what they could see. It was always going to be a parent's decision. Now, I personally, as the head of Instagram, am responsible for Instagram, and I decided to pause that project so that we could take more time to speak to parents, to experts, and to policymakers to make sure that we get it right.
Thank you, Ms. Sherman.
Thanks, Senator Sullivan. Senator Young by WebEx.
Thank you, Chairman. Welcome, Mr. Mosseri. In Ms. Haugen's testimony, she discussed how Instagram generates self-harm and self-hate, especially for vulnerable groups like teenage girls. Now, I happen to have three young daughters and two teenage daughters, and this issue hits home to me, but it hits home to a lot of Americans. So you're here today, you're the head of Instagram, you have an opportunity to tell your side of the story, and I do believe that if we're not receiving some constructive, actionable, and bold measures to deal with what is popularly believed to be a serious and significant public health issue, Congress will act because our constituents insist that we act. We've held a lot of hearings now. We've done our best to educate ourselves, but frankly, since you run the platform, since you know the technology, since you spend so much time working on these matters, you could really help us. If you don't, we're going to feel an imperative to act. So that's just the reality of it. So with that said, with that foundation laid, do you believe there are any short-term or long-term consequences of body image or other issues on your platform?
Senator, I appreciate the question. The research that we have found shows that many teens use Instagram to get support when suffering from issues like body image issues. For 11 out of 12 issues for teenage girls and for 12 out of 12 issues like body image, anxiety, and depression, we found more teens who were struggling found that Instagram made things better than worse. The one exception was body image for teenage girls, which is why I personally, actually before we even did this research, started the social comparison team. That research has inspired ideas like Take a Break, which launched this week, and Nudges, which we're currently working on, which encourages you to switch topics if you spend too much time on any one topic. I'm not here to say that there's any one perfect solution, but just to give an update on what the research says and what we're doing to make Instagram safer.
Got it. I'm familiar with nudges. I'm somewhat familiar with behavioral science. I know that's something that can be harnessed by our tech community to generate traffic. What is engagement-based ranking, Mr. Mosseri?
Senator, I appreciate the question. I've worked on ranking and algorithms for years. That term is often used to describe trying to connect people with content that they find interesting. So what we do when you open up Instagram, as we look at all of the posts from all of the people that you, all the accounts that you follow, and we try and show you the one that you find most relevant, and we try to make sure to take out anything that might be against our community guidelines in order to keep people safe. At a high level, that's usually what people refer to when they say engagement-based ranking, to the best of my knowledge.
So is there a behavioral bias for teenage girls to look disproportionately at content that adversely impacts their self-image?
Not that I know of, Senator. I do think that it's important that teens don't have negative experiences on our platform. I do think it's important that we try to understand the issue that you're raising, which I appreciate, which is negative social comparison or body image social comparison, and we're trying to understand how we can best help and support those who might be struggling.
So there is no negativity bias, just as adults have a negative news bias, which is why so much of the news and current events coverage online can be so caustic and so corrosive to our public discourse. Because so often people marinate in the negative. But there's no similar bias that you have discovered, and I won't hear from one from any of your internal experts pertaining to negative self-image
Senator,
for teenage girls.
Sorry to interrupt you, Senator. Senator, I appreciate the question. I think it's important to call out that social media allows you to connect with anyone you're interested in. And in a world where the definition of beauty here in the United States used to be very limited and very focused on a very unrealistic definition of beauty. Social media platforms like Instagram have allowed, or not allowed, but have helped important movements like body positivity to flourish, so that if you're a teenage girl of color, or if you are a plus size teenage girl, you can see models of color, plus size models. It has helped diversify the definitions of beauty, and that's something that we think is incredibly important. I don't know of any specific bias, to answer your question very directly, but I want to call out that we help people reach a more diverse set of not only definitions of beauty, but points of view and perspectives.
Do you have behavioral scientists who work internal to Instagram?
Senator, we have data scientists who try and understand how people use the platform in order to make Instagram both better and safer.
And they would inform you, I presume, but I don't want to presume, I want to get you on the record. They would be informing you if they ever discovered a negativity bias in the research or in the behaviors of your user community as it relates to teenage girls and self-harm or self-hate, right?
Senator, I expect my data scientists, as I expect my researchers, to keep me abreast of any important developments with regards not only to safety, but to Instagram and the industry more broadly.
Thanks, Senator Young.
Thank you.
Senator Lummis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Companies like Instagram are often designing technology to maximize the collection of our data and subsequently sell visibility into its users' private lives and interests. That's why when a company called Signal bought advertisements designed to show us the information it collects and sells about us, those ads were banned by Instagram's parent company. It's the black box of highly secretive algorithmic systems that companies like Instagram deploy that operate largely undetected by the user and which allow them to continue to operate free of meaningful scrutiny. This is not an open source system. Sunlight disinfects, and Congress must not scroll past this critical moment without properly addressing the harms young people are encountering on these platforms. Mr. Mosseri, thank you for being here. In your testimony, you stated that Instagram has limited advertisers' options for serving ads to people under 18 to age, gender, and location. But your testimony neglects to mention that any similar prohibition on Instagram's own machine learning ad delivery system. Does Instagram's machine learning ad delivery system target ads to children using factors other than age, gender, and location?
Senator, I appreciate the question. There's one ads delivery system both for Instagram and for Facebook. We only allow advertisers to target those under 18 based on age, gender, and location. And overall, the system also uses activity that teens use within the app to make sure that ads are relevant to teens.
Okay, so you don't limit yourselves. You hold yourselves to a lower standard than your advertisers?
Senator, we do limit ourselves in that we don't use any off-platform data, but we do also use activity in the apps to make sure that ads are relevant. For instance, if I'm not interested in a specific band because it's another part of the country or because I don't like that type of music, it doesn't make sense for me to see that type of ad.
So, Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent to enter into the record a report from Fair Play that shows Meta is still using an AI delivery system to target ads at children.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Your head of safety and well-being, Vaishnavi Jay, recently stated that any one piece of content is unlikely to make you feel good or bad or negative about yourself. It's really when you're viewing, say, 20 minutes of that content or multiple pieces of that content in rapid succession that may have a negative impact on how you feel. So to me, her statement says that your company knows that time spent on the platform increases the likelihood of real-world negative impacts. So how do you square a business model that prioritizes user time and engagement with knowing there's a direct correlation between time and harm?
Senator, respectfully, using our platform more will increase any effect, whether it's positive or negative. We try and connect people with their friends. We try to help them explore their interests. We even try to help them start new businesses. But if people don't feel good about the time that they spend on our platform, that's something I personally take seriously, and why we built things like daily limits, and why we're currently working on parental controls that are focused on time.
Does Instagram make money from ads that are seen when placed next to highly viewed and viral, but also harmful content that violates the rules of your platform?
Senator, we don't allow content that violates our rules on the platform. We release publicly how effective we are at removing that content, and we receive revenue based on ads shown.
Okay, so is the money returned to the advertisers then?
Senator, not that I know of, no.
Is it your position that Instagram will always comply with the laws of the country in which it operates?
Senator, we're going to do our best to always comply with the law.
Okay. Will you commit to releasing those guidelines to members of this committee?
Senator, apologies, which guidelines?
It would be guidelines related to how you comply. So let me give you an example. If an authoritarian regime submitted a lawful request for your platform to censor political dissidents, would you comply? And if not, what are your guidelines on something like that? Let me give you some real world examples. If a government, let's say Uganda, criminalizes homosexuality, and if the government submitted a lawful request for a data on users that are members of the LGBT community, would Instagram comply?
Senator, we try and use our best judgment in order to keep people safe. I also believe that transparency on this specific issue is incredibly important. I will double check and get back to your office, but I believe we also are public about incoming requests we get at a high level.
So one of the reasons that I'm concerned about the fact that this is sort of secretive data collection based on a non-open source algorithm is because it gives you that veil of secrecy. People don't know what information is being collected about them. Yet, if a hostile government is able to identify people like women who are learning against the law, being educated against the law, or someone who's homosexual, where in a government where homosexuality is punishable by death, and there are governments that do this. If you turn over that data and it's collected by artificial intelligence, that artificial intelligence is not going to discern that they're putting a human being in danger. The platform, artificial intelligence, when not guided and not open sourced, can be a real problem. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I yield back.
Thanks, Senator. Senator Cantwell.
Thank you, Chairman Blumenthal, and thank you to you and Senator Blackburn for this fabulous hearing. I know we've had great attendance from members. I'm so impressed by the questions that all our colleagues have been asking, so I hope it'll lead us to some good legislative solutions, and appreciate Mr. Mosseri. Is that the right way of saying it, Mosseri?
That's just great.
Okay, for being here today. Obviously, a big new day on the job. So, wanted to ask you specifically about privacy violations. Do you believe that claims of privacy violations by kids should go to arbitration? I mean, that is, do you believe that when people are signing up for your service when they're 14-year-olds, they understand that they are giving away their rights when they sign up to your service?
Senator, respectfully, I disagree with the characterization that anyone gives away their rights when they sign up for our service. I think privacy is incredibly important, and we do the best we can, and we invest a lot of resources in making sure we respect people's privacy.
So if a child has suffered harm of the magnitude and they try to get those issues addressed, do you think they should be in arbitration?
Senator, I'm not sure I understand the exact hypothetical, But I do believe if a child is at risk, specifically of hurting themselves.
I'm not talking about it. No. One of my constituents who is working with a mother whose 14-year-old daughter was groomed by adults on Instagram, ultimately was lured into sex trafficking and taken across state lines for prostitution. Under Instagram's terms of service, Instagram can argue that a child's only recourse against Instagram's failure to provide a safe environment would be an arbitration with no open court, no discovery, no judge, no jury, no appeal. So I'm asking you what you think about when real harm is created against children and what should be the process.
Senator, that story is terrifying. We don't allow child or human trafficking of any kind. We try to be as public as we can about how well we do on difficult problems like that one. And we believe that there should be industry standards, there should be industry-wide accountability, and that the best way to do that is federal legislation, which is specifically what I'm proposing today.
On this point, what we're trying to get at is that when users, in this case particularly young children, are signing up for service, what they're signing up to in a check mark is that you are signing up to binding arbitration with the company. So if there's a dispute about something that happened, and yes, we've been considering privacy legislation. Our colleagues here have been trying to protect young children in other ways, and we've certainly found some very egregious situations of late. The only recourse they have is to go into binding arbitration with you as a company. And we're saying when there's something as egregious as a privacy violation, that they should have other recourse. I'm just simply asking you whether you believe they should have other recourse.
Senator, I appreciate the question. I believe the most responsible approach in this area more broadly, not only for privacy but for safety, is federal regulation here in the U.S.
Do you think everybody has to go through you or one of your other software ask companies to get redress? Do you think that the only redress consumers should have is through binding arbitration with a company?
Senator, I believe that whatever the law states should apply to all companies like ours equally.
I'm asking you what you think as a company.
Senator, I'm not familiar with the specific.
Okay, I'm going to ask you for the record, and then that way you'll get a little more time and you can consider it. But these are serious issues about the fact that serious issues are happening to children, and the only redress they have is to go into binding arbitration with you. And I think while that might be like, hey, I don't like your service, or something happened, or you overcharged me, or this happened, that might be great for binding arbitration. But serious harm to people, I don't think should be sent to binding arbitration. Okay, back to the advertising question, if we could for a second. My colleagues have done a really good job at asking about this. But obviously, people have been talking about the ability to make money off of specific content, whether in the Facebook that was described as potential reach metric. I think we've been talking about that, right? People have been discussing that. Are you aware of inaccuracies in the potential reach metric?
Senator, I'm not aware of any specific inaccuracies, but we do our best we can to make sure advertisers understand reach before they spend using tools like that.
Do you think that there's hate speech that's not taken down by that's included in that? Would you agree that, like, informing advertisers and the public how much hate speech there is, or if it's taken down or not taken down?
Senator, respectfully, I believe the potential reach tool allows you to get a sense of how many people you will reach, which is different than how much content. On hate speech content specifically, in our community standards enforcement report, you can see that I believe 3 in 10,000 pieces of content seen qualifies hate speech by our definition.
Do you think that advertising can be inaccurate or misleading based on certain metrics?
Senator, as an advertising business, I believe it's in our interest to be as accurate as possible. I think whenever we make mistakes, we know that undermines our credibility, and advertising businesses are based on trust.
Right, and they're also based on being truthful to your advertisers. And so what I'm getting at is Ms. Haugen came to testify before the committee. She's saying that Facebook purposely made decision to keep up metrics that drove more traffic, even though she knew that the company knew that it included things that were related to hate speech. That certainly motivated more traffic. And when presented with the information, the company and various members of the company decided to continue using that metric. And so what I'm saying, there could be instances where Instagram has also continued to have advertisers not fully aware. So do you believe advertisers should be aware if there was any content that was related to hate speech, that they should be aware that a metric, that they should be aware of what content they're being served with?
Senator, I believe advertisers should have access to data about how much hate speech there's on the platform, just like everyone should have access to that kind of data. I'm not familiar with what you're specifically referencing with regard to her testimony, but it doesn't line up with any of my experience during my 13 years here at the company that we would intentionally mislead advertisers. That would be a gross violation of trust, and it would inevitably come out and undermine our credibility.
So you don't think there's any deceptive practices with advertisers that you're involved in at Instagram?
Senator, not only do I not believe that, I think that would be...
So you think advertisers know everything about your algorithm and what it is attached to and giving them page views and information?
Senator, I believe deeply in transparency. I've spent an immense amount of time over the years not only trying to be transparent about how our algorithms work, but also investing in making sure we're transparent about how much problematic content is on the platform. And I believe you can see that in a community standards report, and I believe other companies like Snapchat, TikTok, and YouTube should do the same.
I see my time is way over, Mr. Chairman, but I'm going to ask you questions for the record on this as well, because the point is, if companies are involved in deceptive practices with advertisers and they haven't told them how they're artificially increasing their traffic and it's related to something that the advertisers aren't aware of, that is a deceptive practice. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Cantwell. Thanks for your excellent work on this issue and your help and support in these hearings. Senator Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Mosseri, welcome. Thank you for being here. Thank you for testifying before the committee, and thank you for being here in person. As you are aware, I and many members of this committee have had significant concerns about Instagram's practices and Facebook's practices and big tech more broadly. In September 2021, the Wall Street Journal published a series of investigative articles titled The Facebook Files. And as you know, the Wall Street Journal reported that researchers inside of Instagram found that 32% of teen girls using the product felt that Instagram made them feel bad about their bodies. The Wall Street Journal further reported that 13% of British users and 6% of American users trace their desire to kill themselves to Instagram. Now, those are deeply troubling conclusions. Are you familiar with the research that was cited by the Wall Street Journal?
Senator, yes, but if we're going to have a conversation about the research, I think we need to be clear about what it actually says. It actually showed that one out of three girls who suffer from body image issues find that Instagram makes things worse. And that came from a slide with 23 other statistics where more teens found that Instagram made things better. Now, doesn't mean it's not serious. And on suicide, it was actually, and any one life lost to suicide is an immense tragedy. But on suicide, it was 1% who traced their thoughts back to Instagram. And I think it's important that we're clear about what the research says.
So I'm glad to see that we found some common ground. You just said twice there, it's important for us to be clear what the research said. I agree. At prior hearings, I've asked your colleagues repeatedly for copies of the research. And to my knowledge, you have refused to produce it. Will you commit now to produce the research to this committee so we can, as you just said, be clear about what the research says?
Senator, I really appreciate this question because it's incredibly important that we're transparent about research. I can commit personally to doing all I can to release the data behind the research. The two challenges that I need to let you know of are, one, privacy in certain cases, and two, and often cases we do not have the data anymore due to our data retention policies. But given that, I can also commit to you that we will provide meaningful access to data to third-party researchers outside the company so that they can draw their own conclusions and design their own studies to understand the effects of not only Instagram but Facebook on well-being, and I think other companies should do the same.
In what format was this research communicated to you? You just referenced a slide that had bullet points. I would love to see that slide. You criticize this committee for not appreciating the full contents of the research when you haven't given us the research. In what form did this research come to you? Was it a PowerPoint presentation? How was it memorialized and presented to you?
Senator, there are two forms that the research comes in. I believe the most important is the data, because that allows any researcher, and I'm committed to making sure external